Lord, and good morning, everyone. So whether you guys are at home in your PJs or wearing your Sunday best, I'm just super excited just to dig into the Word of God with all of us and just to see what the Lord has to teach us. So before we start, I would love just to start off in prayer. Lord, we just thank you so much for this time that you've given us just to be in your presence, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. What a faithful and true Father you are. I pray that you just be with us time as we just look into your word. I pray that you show us more of who you are and who you call us to be in Christ. And thank you, Lord, for your presence that's always here. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. So the topic that I want to talk about today is the beauty of being in Christ. And so there's nothing super profound or different about this message. It's just simple reminders that the Lord has been telling me as I was reading through 1 Kings. And so we'll be talking through the chapter 1, and then we'll pull in a few verses from chapter 3 and chapter 5. And so first off, what does it mean, the beauty of being in Christ? And so to me, that means it's more than just a name. It's more than just being called a Christ follower. It's more than just being a one-day salvation or one-day prayer. There's just so much more beauty into being in Christ. And so that's kind of what we're going to be digging in today. And so first, we're going to be talking about the beauty of knowing who you belong to. And so in 1 Kings chapter 1, verses 8, it says, "But Zadok the priest, Benaniah son of Jehoiada, Nathan the prophet, Shimei, Ray, and David's personal bodyguard refused to support Adonijah." And so if you're not familiar with the story, it talks about how King David was in his deathbed, and there was a new king that needed to be appointed. And so his son, Adonijah, David's son, he was like, you know what, I want to be king. So he took matters into his own hands, and he kind of did his own thing. He got his people together. He was throwing a great feast. He was kind of going his own way because he wanted that title. And so in this chapter, we see the people who were in the official courts of King David, they were like, no, that's not what I believe King David wants. That's not what the Lord wants. And so they stood their ground. They knew when to say no because they knew who they belonged to. And so when we're in Christ, we get to know who our identity is in. And that's when we get to step into that confidence, because we're not wondering who it is that we belong to. We're not stuck in that midway of like, identity crisis, but you know who you belong to. And so it's not my job to tell you your identity should be in Christ or your identity should be this and that. I would love to tell you that, but it's one thing for me to tell you. It's another thing for you to seek it out and for you to know it for yourself. And so once you experience it for yourself, the truth of knowing who you belong to, then you get to walk in confidence in that. And when you walk in confidence, you're so much more effective when you're with your family, when you're in community. And so that brings us to the second point, which is the beauty of being in community. And so within this, there's a few different points. So first I want to talk from the verse 27 from the same chapter. And it says, "Has my lord the king really done this without letting any of his officials know who should be the next king?" And it was so interesting when I read this verse, because it kind of talks about how the people, King David's officials, they were so surprised that King David hadn't told them what his next plan was. And I was like, whoa, even a king talks to his people about what to do next. He doesn't, even though he's king, he could have easily made the decision, be like, I'm king, I do what's right, or I do what I want to do. But he talks to people. And so that stood out to me. And I was like, that's just the importance of community, the importance of getting feedback, the importance of you don't have to do this alone. The Lord doesn't ask us to do things alone. He wants us to get help from people. And in 1 Kings chapter 5, verses 6, it talks about it's a letter from King David writing to King Hiram, and he is asking him for help. And it's a beautiful letter, honestly. It's very, like, mature and healthy in the way that they interact. And it says, "Therefore, please command that setters from Lebanon to be cut for me. Let my men work alongside you, and I will pay your men whatever wages you ask. As you know, there is no one among us who can cut timber like you Sidonians." And so King Solomon was saying to King Hiram, I know what my people can do, and I know what your people can do. So he knew the strengths and weaknesses of the people. And that's one thing that stood out to me, because something I've always wanted to do is just be good at everything, because why not, you know? But the Lord doesn't ask us to be good at everything. He just gives us a few seeds to be good at. And so it's kind of like a garden, or I look at it as a garden. You know, the Lord gives each of us something specific to be good at. When you look at the church, all of us have different talents. The Lord has blessed some people with the gift of singing, others with the gift of media, others with preaching. And so not all of us have those gifts, but it's so beautiful when we come together and we get to have a service, because it all flows together and it balances everything out. And so the Lord doesn't ask us to do everything. He just asks us to do the few things he gives us with excellence, so that in the end, it points back to the Father. And so that's just the beauty of community. It kind of is like seeds that are being planted, and together brings a beautiful garden of different flowers. And the second point within community is in 1 Kings chapter 1, verses 37. It says, "And may the Lord be with Solomon as he has been with you, my Lord the King, and may he make Solomon's reign even greater than yours." And this verse is talking about Benaniah, one of King David's officials, and he was saying how he was encouraging the next person who's coming after David. He wasn't, like, a lot of times when I look at worldly community, it's like, whoa, you did the best that you could do. There's no one that could top you. But it's different in the way Benaniah talks. He's like, you did what the Lord wanted you to do, King David, but next is going to be King Solomon, and that he's going to reign even greater than you because that's who the Lord has appointed. So when you have godly community, you're surrounded by people who will give you godly perspective. They won't point you back to the world. They won't point you back to what you can do or what you have done. They point you back to the Father because they have that eternal perspective. And so that's so beautiful because for me, it's helped a lot when I've grown up always building up walls and not letting people in because it's so much more easier for me than allowing people into what's actually hurting me and things like that. When you let people in, when you let godly people in, they remind you of who Christ is, because when you go through different situations, different trials, things that hurt you, you kind of forget who it is that the Lord is and you forget the goodness of him. But when you surround yourself with people who love the Lord and who want you to love the Lord just as much, they point you back to the goodness and to the love and the faithfulness of the Father. And so that's just the beauty of being in Christ. You get to have a community who will point you back to Christ. And the third point is the beauty of knowing who to trust. And so in 1 Kings chapter 1, verse 29, it says, "And the king repeated his vow. As surely as the Lord lives, who has rescued me from every danger, your son Solomon will be the next king and will sit on my throne this very day, just as I vowed to you before the Lord, the God of Israel." When I read this, I was like, whoa, how on earth is it that David trusted the Lord so easily? At the beginning of that verse, we see King David saying, "As surely as the Lord lives." On the end, he ends it with saying, "Just as I vowed to you before the Lord, the God of Israel." It's like in his conversation, the Lord just flows through it. How the way that he started his conversation, the way that he ended, it was just the Lord, and it all pointed back to the Father. And so I was like, how is it that David trusts him? And we see this all throughout the Psalms. In Psalm 27, it says, "The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I be afraid of? The Lord is my stronghold." And we see David also referring to the Lord as his rock, as his redeemer. And so how is it that David can trust a God so easily and so, like, greatly? And so when I was thinking about that, it's just David knows who God is. He doesn't doubt him for a second. David knows him as a faithful father who will never leave him. He knows God that even if he goes through the darkest of times, God will be there because he just wants the best for his children. He knows him as a shepherd who cares. And the one thing that God has been constantly telling me even recently is that I never have to have a trust issue with the Lord. Even though growing up I did have maybe a lot of trust issues with different people because of the way that I looked at them, the Lord was like, you never have to have a trust issue with me because I'm faithful, I'm good, I'm the same yesterday, today, and forever, and there's nothing that you have to worry about. And so we see in 1 Kings 1, 11 through 13, and also in verse 17 and 29 through 30, that David was faithful just as his father was faithful, as in our Heavenly Father. We see him saying that he repeated that vow that he had said about being King Solomon being the next king. And so he was faithful to that vow just as the Lord is faithful. And so as we seek the Lord more, as we depend on him more, we take on more of Christ's nature, because that's just what happens. When you spend more time with someone, you automatically just take up that nature. And so that's what we see in the life of David. And the next beauty that we see in being in Christ is the beauty of perspective. So in 1 Kings chapter 3, verses 10 through 12, it says, The Lord was pleased that Solomon had asked for wisdom. So God replied, "Because you have asked for wisdom in governing my people with justice and have not asked for a long life or wealth or the death of your enemies, I will give you what you asked for. I will give you a wise and understanding heart such as no one else has had or ever will have." And so the Lord, as we can see here, is the chapter where the Lord tells Solomon, like, ask me for whatever you want and I'll give it to you. And the Lord is so pleased when Solomon says, I want wisdom, not for my benefit. You know, at the beginning of his reign, we see that he wanted wisdom so that the people that the Lord had entrusted upon King Solomon care, he could lead them in the way that would honor the Lord. And so it reminded me, what is it that we're asking the Lord? What are our prayers look like? Is it self-centered? Is it Lord, even like take away the situation because it makes my name look bad in society. But what if we change our perspective and our prayers? What if we're like, God, what would change? What can you change in my life to make your name more known, to make your people see you better? And we see that's what Solomon asked for, and he was so pleased. And then we also see in 1 Kings chapter 3, verse 28, which is the end of that chapter, it says, when all Israel heard the king's decision, the people were in awe of the king, for they saw the wisdom God had given him for rendering justice. And so when the people saw how King Solomon was ruling and how he was leading the people, they pointed back to God, which is crazy because they were like, the wisdom that God gave Solomon. And so when the Lord gives you something, it's never for our own gain. It's never to build up our name. But the Lord gives us something so that we can build up his kingdom, his name, and his glory. And that could be that job that we got. That could be the grade that we got on the test. It could be everything and anything. Because when we look at our lives and we just kind of take an inventory of all the things the Lord has given us, we always have to be like, Lord, why is it you gave me this new job? Why is it you gave me this grade on this test? Why is it you gave me this and that? What is your purpose in it? What is it you want to get out of this for your glory and for your kingdom? And so in the end, everything the Lord gives us, we have to look at it from his perspective. Are we doing and using the things that the Lord gives us to build up his kingdom, or is it to build up our own kingdom? Because when we have godly community, like I said before, they'll help us have an eternal perspective so that we can always be pointed back to the Father. And the last point that I want to make is about the beauty of obedience. And so 1 Kings chapter 1, verses 49 through 51, it says, then all of Adonijah's guests jumped up in panic from the banquet table and quickly scattered. Adonijah was afraid of Solomon, so he rushed to the sacred tent and grabbed onto the horns of the altar. Word soon reached Solomon that Adonijah had seized the horn of the altar in fear and that he was pleading, let King Solomon swear today that he will not kill me. It was so interesting because at the beginning of that verse, we see that Adonijah's guests jumped up in panic. And when I read that, it reminded me of when I was little, me and my siblings, when it was the summertime, we would have to learn memory verses. And my parents would give us instructions before they went off to work of how many memory verses to learn that day. And so they would tell us that, and they would go off to work. So technically, we had the next 8 hours to do whatever we wanted because my parents weren't there to watch us. So we could choose to learn the memory verses. We could choose to watch TV or to go outside and play or to mess with different things around the house. And as you can guess, we messed around with anything and everything we could find in the house except studying the memory verses. And so when it came to around 4:45, 5 o'clock p.m., my parents were about to come home, that the panic set in. I can't speak for my siblings, but for me, it set in. I was like, oh, no. My parents are going to come back, and the first question they're going to ask me is, how many memory verses did you learn? And so it just reminded me of that. If I just took the moment to yield and to obey my parents in the first place, I would never have to have that set of panic right before they came in. And so it just reminded me to ask, what would our life look like, though, if we took that moment to yield, to listen to the Lord, and to walk in obedience with that? How much more beneficial, how much more purposeful, how much more peaceful would our life be when we walk in obedience to that? But it's important to yield. It's important to not just rush into things or to be like, I want this, I want that, because that's my desires. But when we take that moment to yield and to kind of slow down and pause and ask the Lord, Lord, what is it that you want? And then obey. The important part is the obeying part. Then we get to see the fruits of the Lord just working in our lives. And so the worship team can come up, and I just want to wrap up here. But we see the beauty of the Lord in so many different ways. You know, being in Christ means that we get the beauty of knowing who it is that we belong to. We get to know who our identity is in. We get to know the beauty of being in community, especially godly community. We know the beauty of who to trust, the beauty of perspective, and the beauty of obeying the Lord. And so in 1 Kings chapter 3, verse 26, it says, then the woman who is the real mother of the living child and who loved him very much cried out, oh no, my Lord, give her the child. Please not kill him. But the other woman said, all right, he will be neither yours nor mine. Divide him between us. When I read this, it reminded me of the parallelism to the New Testament where it talks about in Revelation where God hates lukewarm people. He doesn't want us to be divided. He doesn't want a child of God who's divided half in this world, half in the Lord's kingdom. He wants all of us. He wants all of us to be in Christ, not just half of us, not just a part of us. He wants not just the easy parts that are to surrender to him, but the messy, the ugly, even the parts that are uncomfortable. He wants all of that because God's not scared of that. He wants the parts that are so hard to give up and so hard to surrender. Because once we do that, once we find the beauty in being in the Lord, we find that we have safety and we have refuge. And then we realize that our God is my God. It's not the God of my parents. It's not the God of my grandparents. But I can truly call God my own God because I've experienced him for myself. And so I want to leave us with this question. What would our lives actually look like if we were living in the beauty of Christ? And so I just want to end off in prayer. Father, we just thank you so much for this time that you gave us just to learn from your word. I just pray that you teach us the beauty of being in Christ. I thank you, Lord, that you have called us your children. You have adopted us into your sonship. And I pray that you would not let us take that for granted, just the opportunity to be a part of your family. And I pray that we would be able to know you as Abba, Father, as the one who is beautiful in every aspect, faithful in all you do, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for your presence. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.